Hi guys, this is Bruce. Today we've got a handout called The Finished Work of Christ. This talks about, it goes through the scripture and looks at a bunch of verses that explain how God did in Christ, through Christ, what we could never do for ourselves. And that's not just for you and me, that's for the entire world. So this finished work of Christ was done through Christ, and we are the benefactors. We are the ones who are receiving all that he has done for us. And there's a lot of things to talk about. You've got a handout called The Finished Work of Christ. You see that? It should look just like that. The Finished Work of Christ. So take your Bible. I want to encourage you to put stuff away, make a place for you where you can sit down with your pen, highlighter, look at your Bible, and if you don't have your Bible ready, you know, just do it how you want to. But I want you to, just encouraging you to get into this. You're going to get out of this what you want to put into it. So our prayer, Father, we're asking you to speak to us and reveal your word to us, but to reveal yourself to us in all these things that we're talking about. So look, let's look at the first one. Number one on our sheet is all your sins are forgiven. And the reference there, the first one we'll go through, is Ephesians 4:32. So in Ephesians it says, be kind to one another, tenderhearted, forgiving each other, just as God in Christ has also forgiven you. What we're looking for right there is the fact that Christ has already forgiven us. That God in Christ and through Christ has already forgiven us. So our little statement there on number one, all your sins are forgiven. This is just evidence of that. Now turn over to your right a few pages and go to Colossians. Colossians 2:13 is what we're looking at. And 2:13 says, when you were dead in your transgressions. Another way to put that is when you were dead in your sin. When you were just dead in the water. When you had no hope. When you were dead in your transgressions and the uncircumcision of your flesh, meaning, you know what? All you are is a person trying to meet your own needs apart from God. And circumcision means the cutting away of that. You are still left with just being in your flesh. You had no other way to live. When you were dead in that condition, and I don't mean physically dead. I mean that you had no hope. You didn't know up from down in that. It says that when you were dead like that, he made you alive together with him, with Jesus, it says, he made you alive together with him, having forgiven us all our transgressions. Do you see what I mean there? Are you following me? He made you alive together with Christ. This is what God has done, having forgiven us all our transgressions. You know what? You might take a pen, just like I'm fixing to do, and you might underline or put a circle around that. All. He's forgiven us all of our transgressions. Okay, now keep going over to your right to 1 John. And it's way toward the back of the Bible. 1 John 2:12. That's what we're looking for. 1 John 2:12. We'll give you a second to get there. And he says, I'm writing to you, little children, because your sins have been forgiven you. Because your sins have been forgiven you for his name's sake. And the idea when he's saying, I'm writing to you children, I'm writing to you who are believers. I'm writing to you children of God. Not just that we're all God's children, but those who are believers. I'm writing to you children of God, basically, because your sins have been forgiven you for his name's sake. So your sins are forgiven. Number one, all your sins are forgiven. This is fantastic. Now what I want to do is I want to skip to 3 before we go on to 2. Let's skip to 3, and we're going to go back to Colossians. So we're going to really read Colossians 2:14. And I want to read the 13 again, because that was in number 1, but I don't want us to forget it. I'm going to read the second part of verse 13. It says, "He made you alive together with him, having forgiven us all our transgressions, having canceled out the certificate of debt consisting of decrees against us, which was hostile to us. And he has taken it out of the way, having nailed it to the cross." The idea is that the record of charges against you has been canceled out. That's number 3 on our list. It's been canceled out. And it's been nailed to the cross. Colossians 2:14. So all the charges that would be here, this is what he's done. This is what she's done. All that list of things that's right there. All of those have been canceled out, nailed to the cross. So, but what charges are against you? Now, by the way, we need to kind of work on an idea or some things here. Listen, this is not saying that if you're in prison and you've got charges against you, that all of a sudden all those charges are going to be dropped. I think we got a little bit of confusion going on. We get excited about this grace thing, and we think we're out from under the law. Well, we are out from under the law. We're out from under the law, the biblical law of the requirements of what it takes to be righteous. That's what we're freed from. Do I still need to stop at a red light when I'm going down the road? Yes, I'm under that, but in grace, I'm able to do that. I'm able to say, I think I need to stop at that red light. Hey, I think it's not good for me to drive while I'm drinking or after I've drunk, right? It's not that I'm freed from the law and I don't have to, who cares anymore? I can just drive drunk or whatever, or drink myself into oblivion and not take care of my family and lose my kids and everything else. Oh, there's grace for you from God. Grace has mercy for you, but he wants you to come out of that. Do you feel that? I hope you see what I mean here. So this record of charges that Satan would put against you, saying you're not worthy of being a child of God, all that's been dropped, okay? And so no one can accuse you. Christ has done this. But now, if you've gone out and stolen some stuff, you may have to serve some time in jail. If you go hurt somebody, or if you murdered somebody, God's not going to pat you on the back and say, well, you know, we're not going to let them press any charges against you. He's going to say, son, I love you. I'm not holding this against you. But they are, because you did it. Do you follow me? And it doesn't even mean God's happy with it or condones it. It just means between you and God, he's not going to throw you out. He's not going to give up on you. See, this is exciting stuff. I mean, if you can feel that, but I hope you realize the reality of living in this. This is not a deal where, oh boy, you're living in grace now, so there's no more rules like at the Salvation Army or anywhere for that matter. There are rules all over the place. But in grace now, as I receive this grace from God, I'm able to walk out and be sensible. When they ask me not to do stuff, you know, I can go along with it. Why? Because I'm trusting God. Do you follow what I'm saying? If they're asking me not to bring food up into my room, I wonder if there's a reason for that. Do you think there could be a reason for that? That maybe if everybody brought food up there, can you imagine how nasty the Salvation Army could be? Rats, bugs, mice, who knows what would come up in there? The homeless people that come in there, can you imagine cooking beans in their room? Come on, there's got to be something that helps us until we come to this faith to where we're always thinking about other people, where we come in the Salvation Army or anywhere and say, what can I do to help you? Instead of what can you do to help me? See, this is this. Do you feel this a little bit? Look, God has created us to trust Him and to live from love to everyone else. Quit worrying about if others are not treating you right. What about you? Are you treating them right? Are you letting God's love flow into you and to them? See, that's the idea. Yeah, but we've been so selfish, we don't even know how to get out of that and think outside of that. So I'm encouraging you, have a new thought. What is that? Well, we'll put it up there. What does that mean? What does that remind you of? Have a new thought. Think again. See, that's the idea. Think again. And that is what repent means. To repent is have a new thought. Have a new thought. Let's put that. Have a new thought. To repent. Better, or to add with it, change your mind. Have a new thought, change your mind. That's what we're talking about. Okay, let's go up to number two. Satan has been disarmed and defeated. So look at Colossians 2:15, right where you were. And when he had disarmed the rulers and authorities, he made a public display of them, having triumphed over them through him. God, by raising Jesus from the dead, Jesus paid the death, was buried, but then he was raised from the dead in triumph. In triumph, Satan has been disarmed and defeated. All he can do is bug you. All he can do is make you think stuff, or when I say make you think, he can't even really make you think. He just shoots fiery darts of thoughts into your head. He can suggest things to you, and you can choose to buy it hook, line, and sinker. We could go on and on with all that. But let's go down to four. Verse number four on our sheet. The old sin-loving sinner you were has been crucified and is dead, buried, and gone. Turn your Bible over to the left until you get to Romans. We're still in the far right side of your Bible. We're not going to get much further out of that. Turn to Romans chapter 6, verse 4. And our statement was, on number 4, that the old sin-loving sinner you were has been crucified, is dead, buried, and gone. Romans 6:4 says, therefore, we have been buried with him, with Jesus, through baptism into death, so that as Christ was raised from the dead through the glory of the Father, so we too might walk in newness of life. As he was raised from the dead, he was our representative. We were in him. And so now we too walk in newness of life just like he did after being raised from the dead. This is, he's our representative. I was in him. You were in him. This isn't just me. All of us. The sin of the whole world was in Christ. He was taking that. So the old sin-loving sinner you were is gone. You've been raised to new life. No, and then now let's go over to your right. We're going to go to Galatians. It's not very far. We're going to Galatians chapter 2, verse 20. I think we did this one again the other day. Galatians 2:20. It's on our other sheet. Man, these verses crisscross, you know, and what you can pull out of them too, because it's all the truth, but they start blending together. You start seeing a picture of the whole story. Galatians 2:20, I have been crucified with Christ. It is no longer I who live, but Christ lives in me. And the life which I now live in the flesh, I live by faith in the Son of God who loved me and gave himself up for me. Let's read it here. Number five. The old you no longer lives, But Christ lives in you, and you now live by the faith of the Son of God, who loved you and gave himself for you. So you no longer live. I'm going back to our verse, 2:20. It's no longer I who live, but Christ lives in me. I'm not just me for me on my own. I'm not just orphan me. It says now, but Christ lives in me. And the life which I now live in the flesh, I live by faith in the Son of God. Some versions read of the Son of God, which is actually a more accurate translation. It's like it's God's faith. It's Jesus' faith given to me. And that's how I live, by his faith. So I live by the faith of the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me. Tremendous. All right, let's go to 6. We need to go back now. Let's go back to Romans. You might keep your place. Well, actually, it'll be a while before we're back to Galatians, but just go back to Romans. This will be a good little exercise for you anyway. So go to Romans 6:11. And on our sheet, it says, you're dead to sin and alive to God. So Romans 6:11 says, even so, consider yourselves to be dead to sin, but alive to God in Jesus Christ. Consider yourself to be dead to sin. You don't have a relationship to it anymore. Well, it doesn't have anything to do with you. What are you doing living in sin? What is sin? Sin equals separation. You are dead. Another way to put it, let me go ahead and take that back off. Is that okay? You have died to separation, right? You're not separated. Look at what he's done. God has done all this. You have believed into him. You're a new creation in Christ. You're no longer separated. So you've died to separation, which is sin. Same thing. So let's put it like this. You have died to this. Now you're no longer separated. Right? How can you be separated if you've believed into Christ, if you received him? He comes to live inside of you. So you're dead to sin and alive to God. Turn to your right, 1 Corinthians. It's just at the end of Romans. Look at 1 Corinthians 6:11. I was going to say, let's start with 3:16. Let's do number 8. 1 Corinthians 3:16. 1 Corinthians 3:16 says, do you not know that you are a temple of God? And that the Spirit of God dwells in you? You're the temple of God, and God dwells in you. Do you know that? Do you know? Do you not know that your body's a temple of God? You're no longer separated. Let's put this. He lives in you. Now, let's put this word down. This is huge. This is unbelievable when you really look at it and think about it. There's union. There's union here. You live in union with God. God the Father, Father, Son, Holy Spirit. Give me a T there. You follow me? You're in union. You're in union. Think about it. God dwells inside of you. Go over it. Think about it again. God dwells in me. Then what are you doing living as if you're separated? There is no more. You've died to this. You've died to the separation. You are no longer. And let's put this. And raised to no longer separated. This is what we're carrying around. no longer separated. You can't be separated. You're welded together. You're fused together like the coffee and the water. All right, where'd we switch? Let's do 7 now. And so turn over in 1 Corinthians to 6. 1 Corinthians 6:11. Let's look at it. It says, such were some of you. Now he talks about living lives. Well, he's talking about idolaters, adulterers, thieves, covetous, drunkards, right? And such were some of you. But, this is verse 11. But you were washed, but you were sanctified, but you were justified in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ and in the Spirit of our God. Do you hear that? Man, this is what God has done. Such were some of you. Some of you were idiots. Some of you were, that's a good way to put it. I was, that's why I could say that. Some of us were idiots. Some of us lived insane. Come on, you guys, I've heard you talk about that. You know what I'm talking about. We've been idiotic in our behavior. We've been desperate in our behavior. Tell me you love me. Tell me I'm okay. Please accept me. Please accept me. Whine and cry and we'll act that way in all kinds of ways. I don't want you. And inside I'm, oh, please, would you just want me? Would you accept me? On the outside, we can act all, we're fine. I don't need anybody. And you're crying out on the inside as if you are totally lost. And your best way to put it is you're an orphan in your thinking. You want a home desperately. You need a home. You need a place to belong. And this is what Christ has done for all of us. This was me. This was all of us. Some of us are just getting better at admitting it. And I hope you're able to do that too. 9. Let's look at 9. Let's skip now. Let's turn to Colossians again. That'll be to your right. Past Galatians and Ephesians and Colossians. You'll get right there. And it's Colossians chapter 3, verse 4. So look at it with me. If I'm going fast, I'm sorry. I want you to be able to turn there. It's good for you to do it. You'll get familiar with some of the scriptures. 3, verse 4, chapter 3 of Colossians, verse 4. It says, for when Christ, well, look, let's read verse 3 because it fits right with it. For you have died and your life is hidden with Christ in God. Wait a minute. Let's do this. I'm going to make a note of this too. Christ is your very life. We need to do Colossians. I'm losing my pen marking. We need to do 3:1-4. That's the way we're going to do that. Colossians 3:1-4. I'm going to mark it here in my Bible too, like that, because this is too good. It says, therefore, verse 1. So Colossians 3, we're looking at verse 1 now. Neat scriptures. Therefore, if you've been raised up with Christ, you've been raised up Christ was raised from the dead, you've been raised up with him. You're a new creation now in Christ. If you've been raised up with Christ, keep seeking the things above where Christ is, seated at the right hand of God. This is who he is and this is where he is now. And it says in verse 2, set your mind. You can do that, by the way. All of us can. You'll set your mind on something and you won't let anybody get you off of it. So-and-so did me wrong and I'm fixing to go tell them off. And they'll say, hey, well, come on, you don't need to do that. No, I'm going to tell them off. I'm going to go tell them what I think about this thing. You can set your mind. You won't change your mind. When people decide that they're going to leave a Reconnect program, or if people decide they're going to do such and so, they're going to the store today, whether they feel bad or not, or that's changing these days. But, you know, things like that. You set your mind on it and you're going to do it. You've decided this is what you're going to do and you're not going to change it. That's setting your mind. So it says right here, therefore, if you have been raised with Christ, keep seeking those things which are above, higher things. It's not just up. but higher, a higher plane, who we are in the spiritual realm. It says where Christ is seated at the right hand of God right now. It says, set your mind on things above, not on the things on the earth. For you have died and your life is hidden with Christ in God. You've died and your life is hidden with Christ in God. You see, you've died and you've been raised, no longer separated. He lives in you, union with God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. This is incredible. And it says, when Christ, who is our life, is revealed, then you also will be revealed with him in glory. In a glorious revelation. Doesn't mean necessarily later on. It can be right now. When Christ, who is our life, that's just a huge statement. Christ is your life. You're so, sorry to use my marker, other marker. When you are so in union with him, he is your life. Listen to that. He is your life. He's in you. And not just in you. I mean, this is so... Can you dwell on it for a minute? Can you just meditate on that? He is your life. He really is. What would that mean? What would that mean to you? If Christ was really in you, and he is actually able to motivate, able to do whatever it is he is calling you to do, asking you to do. See the doing of it. I don't want to focus on that, but you're able to be it because he is it in you. Then you can trust him. Why am I so bent out of shape all the time? Why do you still keep trying to live by the flesh? You know what? I can get in that mode. I can do it too. Man, this is the truth. Okay, let's go from Colossians. We're going to go back to 2 Corinthians. So turn to your left. And we're going to go to 2 Corinthians. And it's 5:17. 2 Corinthians 5:17. And that says, Therefore, because of all this, because of everything we've said, and now he's saying other stuff even right here, which is really fantastic. And we talked about some of this on some other sheets. So you need to get those other handouts and listen to those too, the videos that go with it. In 17, it says, therefore, if anyone is in Christ, okay, didn't we already establish that? If anyone is in Christ, he lives in you. Then this means you are, let's put it up here so we'll have plenty of room. You are a new creation. You get it? You're a new creature. If anyone is in Christ, he is a new creature. The old things passed away, behold, new things have come. New creature. New creation. Fantastic. So, if anyone is in Christ, the old has passed away, a new has come. The same idea we've been talking about. 11, go back to your left to Romans. We're going to Romans 8 real quick. This is a short one. Romans 8, there's no more condemnation. There's no more shame. There's no more punishment from God. We're not talking about not going to jail if you steal my car. Hopefully you'll go to jail. Now, I don't mean because it's my car, but you shouldn't get away with that. That's ridiculous, right? But God is not looking to, I'm going to whip that boy or that girl. So look at Romans 8:1. It says, therefore, because of all these things, and once again, because of all these things, there is now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. And I'm going to add a little bit to it. So mark on your sheet, we're going to add Romans 8, 2 and 3 and 4. Romans 8, 2 through 4. So we'll add that to the sheet there on number 11. Now let's read it. It says, therefore, there is now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. For the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus has set you free from the law of sin and death. The law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus has set you free from the law of sin and death. For what the law could not do, weak as it was through the flesh, because the law demanded my flesh to perform for God. It demands me to do what I can't do. So the law was weak because of me. You follow me? And because of you. God did what the law could not do. God did, is our verse 3. Sending his own son in the likeness of sinful flesh, and as an offering for sin, he condemned sin in the flesh. So here's the idea. He gave his life to pay for the penalty of sin. And so he was able to condemn sin in the flesh because he took the penalty of it and died the sin death. Then look at verse 4. So that he took that and did that was the offering for sin, so that the requirement of the law might be fulfilled in us who do not walk according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. It would be fulfilled in us as we learn to walk in union with God in the Spirit as new creations on the earth. New creation. You are a new creation. Get that in your head. Tell it to each other. Hey, I don't usually do this. Everybody turn to each other, whoever's in there, and say, you are a new creation in Christ. You're a new creation in Christ. You. If you're a believer, and I think most of you are, then you're a new creation in Christ. You are Christ in you. Turn to everybody and say that. You are Christ in you. You are Christ in you. It's very easy to do it. Just turn and say it. You are Christ in you. That's awesome. 12. Go to Galatians. Back to your right. You ought to be getting good at this. Back to Galatians 6:14. Okay, Galatians 6:14. And it says that the world on our sheet, it says the world has been crucified to you and you have been crucified to the world. Galatians 6:14. Now over in Galatians it says, but may it never be that I would boast except in the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ, through which the world has been crucified to me and I to the world. Now listen, you can't live that out without him doing that in you. The world has been crucified to him and he has been to the world, and that was in Christ's death because I was in Christ. Now the world doesn't meet my needs. The world. Okay, we're picked back up at 13. You are born again and have overcome the world. This will be 1 John. So look back over to the right. Go to 1 John. And it's 5, verse 4. 1 John 5, 4. Way back to the right, right before Revelation. So look at that. And I'll read it, 5:4 says, but whatever is born of God overcomes the world. And this is the victory that has overcome the world, our faith. This is the victory that has overcome the world, our faith. So whatever is born of God, the only reason you're born of God is because you've believed into him, right? And God has given you the gift of faith to believe in him. So whatever is born of God, so if you believe in him, you're born of God. And it says, whatever is born of God overcomes the world. And this is the victory that has overcome the world, our faith. So that was 1 John 5 and 4. And now look over at Colossians. Go to your left. Go back to Colossians. And we're going to look at 1:27. But also, we're going to look at verse 26. So go to Colossians 14. It started to say galoshes. Did y'all ever wear galoshes back in the day? I don't know if they still even have them around, but we had galoshes. I don't think I ever had any, but some kids did. So, 14, Christ in you is the hope of glory. Colossians 1, I want to read 26. That is the mystery. We're starting in the middle of a thought, but it'd take too long to go back. It says, that is the mystery which has been hidden from the past ages and generations, but has now been manifested to his saints, to whom God willed to make known what is the riches of the glory of this mystery among the Gentiles, which means anybody that's not a Jew, but the idea is this mystery is for the whole world. That's the idea. It's for everyone, which is Christ in you, the hope of glory. This mystery, Christ in you, how does this work? How does God get inside of us? This is the mystery, and it's the only hope of achieving new creation stuff. You can't go try to be a new creation without being one. You know what I mean? You can't do this apart from him. The part of the problem is you've been trying from this separation standpoint, you've been wanting to do new creation stuff. So you're trying to make your flesh fit in with new creation stuff. You can't do that. It doesn't work. So it says that Christ in you is the hope of glory. Christ in you, union with Christ. That's the only way that this new creation, that's the only way you become a new creation, much less do new creation stuff. It has to be him in you. And 15, just look down a little bit further in Colossians chapter 2, verse 10. You are complete in Christ, it says on our sheet, and he is the head of all rule and authority. In verse 10, Colossians right there, says, and in him you've been made complete. You've been made full. That's the idea of completed, full, fulfilled. And he is the head over all rule and authority. Think about it. The one who is the head of all rule and authority is in union with you. He is your life. You think you can't be a new creation? He is the one over, he's the head over all authority. Of course you can be a new creation. There's no question. Do you believe it? Do you believe it? Do you receive this from me? I mean, not... Do you receive this truth from the Word? Yes, I'm giving it, but do you receive it? It's alive. This Word is alive even as you're hearing it. Okay, look at 16. Jesus is in the Father, and you are in Jesus, and Jesus is in you. So look back to your left. Go to just the regular John. It's one of the Gospels. And look for John 14. And in John 14, I'm going to start back a little before it. I'm going to start at verse 18. So you need to mark that down. I need to do it too. John 14, 18 through 20. Okay? So what it says in 18 is this is Jesus talking. He says, I will not leave you as orphans. I'll not leave you abandoned. You follow me? I won't leave you alone. Orphans are alone. They're not necessarily usually. They can be abandoned. They don't know their parents. Or maybe they do, but they're not in their life, right? You know what I'm saying. You can say, well, sometimes, whatever. But basically, everybody knows an orphan. I felt like an orphan. I had a mom and dad. I wished I was an orphan back in those days. I resented having a mom and dad. But an orphan. He says, I will not leave you as orphans. I will come to you. After a little while, the world will no longer see me, but you will see me because I live. You will live also, and not as an orphan. He says, in that day, you'll know that I am in my Father, you are in me, and I am in you. This union of relationship, he says, in that day, you're going to know something. You're going to know that I'm in my Father, you are in me, and I am in you. This is incredible. Jesus is in the Father, you're in Jesus, and Jesus is in you. Father, help us to get this. Today, as we talk about all this, Lord, set our minds, put us to a place to where we'll start thinking, God is in me. Jesus is in me. I'm one with the Father. I'm one with Jesus. Lord, teach me how to walk being one with Jesus. How do I live like this? I'm used to doing my thing. I get mad over everything. I get upset when I don't get my way. Teach us, Lord, how to trust you and believe that you're bringing us into real life. You're bringing us into new creation life. What is that like? What is that like? Okay, I've got a little something I want us to do. You should have three envelopes. So everybody anybody watching this video should have three envelopes with you. And I want you to have just a little piece of paper. You could have a 3x5 card or just a little tear. It doesn't have to be good or anything. Just a little piece of paper that you have. Now, if you need to, stop the video and get ready. But here's what you should do. On the little piece of paper, I want you to write Jesus. Okay? So that's all you got to do on the little piece of paper. Just write Jesus. So then set that aside. Now you're going to take your another envelope. You should have three envelopes. And on one envelope, you're going to write your name. So I just put you here so you'd get the idea, you. On the other side of mine, I'm real clever. I put me so that when I'm seeing it, I know what it is. But you can put your name on it. I could put Bruce on this, you know. But I want you to see the picture of it. This is you, and it's also me. I want you to take another envelope and write Jesus on it. If you need to stop the video, go ahead. It's all right. But put Jesus on the next envelope. All right? And then on the last envelope, I want you to put the Father. You can put the Father, Father, Father God. But get Father on there because that's what we're talking about. Our verses back here, the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit. He is our Father. We're no longer orphans. We're his. Okay? So get that. Now, if you need to, stop the video. Make sure everybody's got it. Three envelopes. You, the Father, and Jesus. And then the little piece of paper that has Jesus on it. Now, let's look at our verse. John 14:20 was the last one we ended up with. In John 14:20, it says, and Jesus is speaking. He says, in that day, you will know that I'm in my Father, you are in me, and I am in you. Okay, I want us to see how this works out. I want you to take the envelope that says you, has your name on it, however you did it. Me, it's mine, and me, and it's you. And when you believe into Christ, I want you to take the little piece of paper that has Jesus on it, and you put that inside you. You receive Christ into your life. It says he is in you. He lives in you. Your union with God. He is your life. But I want you to see something else. Now, Jesus says that I'm in the Father, you are in me, and I'm in you, and I'm in you. My Father, you are in me, and I am in you. So Jesus says not only is he in us, remember, I just put him in there, but he says you are in me. So take your envelope that has Jesus on it. And you may have to take your, mine are bigger than yours, I know. But you take it, fold it up, and you put it inside Jesus. I got to find my opening here. So you take you, and you put it inside Jesus. You follow me? And now he says, I want you to know that in that day, you'll know that I'm in my Father. Jesus says, I am in my Father. So take your last envelope, the Father, I know it's smaller, you'll have to fold this one up again, and you'll place it inside of the Father. So now, you should have an envelope left that is just the Father. Now, what I want you to see is this, that if anything comes to you, and if anything is coming your way, first it has to go through the Father, and then it has to go through Jesus before it ever gets to you. And when it gets to you, it finds you filled with Jesus. My goodness, guys. He's got us in his hands. He's in us, and we're in him.